You're at 109 right now.
Holy smokes, y'all. So these are my first impressions of reading the liner notes. I guess that's on the dust jacket, these inserts in the book. These are my first impressions of Ross Russell's book entitled Bird Lives. Wow, just wow, wow, wow. Okay. This is amazing because just reading about Charlie Parker, the little bit that I just read, everything sums up Jean-Michel Basquiat's life. And I'm going to read it to you. It says, let's see. Yeah. Charlie Parker was the first angry black man in music. And the first to carry the battle to the enemy. All right, I'm going to just stop right there because that's what Jean-Michel Basquiat was doing with his artwork. He was an angry black man in art. That's Basquiat. And probably, maybe he wasn't the first, but he is the important one to carry the battle to the enemy. Basquiat would crown black men his heroes, right? In his artwork. So that's what you're looking at. You're looking at, he's bringing the battle to the enemy, saying, damn it, these men deserve royalty. It continues, because he was ahead of his time, he was a lonely and frustrated man. That's what the Ross Russell intro, you know, the liner notes on the dust jacket say about Charlie Parker. But that's the truth about Basquiat as well. So I'm sure Basquiat identified with Charlie Parker in his life and his story. He was lonely and frustrated, especially when he died, around the time that he died, because Andy Warhol was his confidant. Someone told the story about Basquiat being distraught after Andy Warhol died. And so Basquiat, he was inconsolable, they described him as. And he said he couldn't talk to anyone. When Andy Warhol died, Basquiat couldn't express himself, couldn't share his innermost thoughts with anyone. He didn't trust anyone and didn't feel the level of comfort with anyone. The only person he felt comfortable with was Andy Warhol. And so when he died, Basquiat's world crumbled as well. And he was there all alone. And so he drew into himself. So he was alone. He was sad, depressed. And so 18 months after Andy Warhol died, Jean-Michel Basquiat died. There was no reason for him to die. You know, he was 27 years old. Sadly, he was hooked on heroin, Basquiat was. But, he could have, I mean, he was healthy enough to have, you know, lived a better life, had things, you know, been better for him, had he not been so alone. But that heroin overdose took him out. So he was lonely and frustrated. Then it continues. It says, the futility of the blows he directed at the white establishment did much to feed his dependence upon heroin and alcohol and to accelerate a seemingly compulsive rush toward self-destruction. So that's what it is. That's what it was for Charlie Parker. But that's what it was for Basquiat as well. It says the futility of the blows he directed at the white establishment. The works of art by Jean-Michel Basquiat are blows directed at the white establishment. Look at Irony of a Negro Policeman. That work is about police brutality. It's about, you know, it's about just what the title says, the irony of a black policeman. The black man is doing to the black man The black man as a policeman is an agent of white supremacy, essentially. That ain't cool. So Basquiat is painting about that to say, look at this. Look at this. Look at how ironic it is. Pay attention to this. Basquiat in his artwork, you know, it's the crown. He's giving crowns to the men who are heroes, who are not being highlighted or not being praised or not given as much praise as they should in their society, in the American society. Now, that really reminds me of Taraji P. Henson right now. Taraji P. Henson is a queen. She deserves her crown. And yet, look at how the white establishment treats her. She said for years she's had to stay strong while being underpaid for her work. Taraji P. Henson received $100,000+ for her role in Benjamin Button's, while Brad Pitt received $10 million for his role. Like, the math ain't mathing, they say. Like, make it make sense, y'all. So Basquiat, in his artwork, that was his voice. He was telling us this stuff, showing us. So it is, everything is everything. You know, Basquiat's art is relevant because he spoke those unpopular truths in his artwork. So I'm just like blown away by this book already, just by having read that. Oh, the other thing, Charlie Parker was a wild man, a wild nigga, as they would call it. Some book I read, they said there are a few types of niggas. They're like, I don't know. I guess they're only the two niggas I recall. They said they are like maybe the wild nigga and a crazy nigga. I think so. The crazy nigga, you know, crazy. Man, that nigga's crazy. You know, that's what you hear about them. I don't know what the crazy niggas do, but they do crazy stuff. Maybe there was a wild nigga. Maybe there's a wild man, but wild and crazy are kind of synonymous. So maybe the wild and the crazy are the same. I don't know. But let's talk about the wild or the crazy nigga. Charlie Parker was a crazy nigga. Like, we see crazy niggas today. Kanye West is the top. He's the king crazy nigga, right? But Jack Johnson in his day was a crazy nigga. The white establishment said white men and black men and white women are not supposed to have relations. Jack Johnson said, man, forget that. I'm gonna do my thing. And Jack Johnson went and had his escapades, his affairs with white women, openly, you know, doing that. He was speed in his car. These are the stories that I know. He was speed in his car. You know, when speeding wasn't, you know, for one, he was speeding. Two, he was a black man, you know, driving a car when, you know, cars weren't, you know, so readily available to the average man. He was a big deal, and he was just breaking the rules, you know. So he was a crazy nigga of his time, Jack Johnson. Kanye's in Italy having his girlfriend or new wife, you know, perform fellatio on him in public. Yeah, that's a crazy one right there. And you know all the other things that Kanye has said recently, from slavery was a choice to the first outburst by Kanye was George Bush doesn't like black people, you know. The point here is that this book is correct. It's a lonely, frustrated road that Charlie Parker traveled, but so is it for Kanye West, perhaps for Jack Johnson, you know, and anyone else who is a crazy nigga. Eldridge Cleaver comes to mind. Black Panther. you know, chairman, minister, Eldridge Cleaver. Eldridge Cleaver, in his book, Soul on Ice, wrote about openly raping white women. I think he said out of consternation. I think that's the term he used. And he admitted it. It was true. Like, wow. And then Eldridge Cleaver even created a pair of jeans, like the penis jeans, where the penis is prominently displayed. There's a pouch. There's a pocket for the penis, and it's outward facing. So your penis hangs outside of your pants. Your penis is covered, but it hangs outside. It's not, you know, it's not covered, but it's out there. It's prominent. That was Eldridge Cleaver saying, "Yeah, man, this is what it is." That's crazy. You know, Eldridge Cleaver, another crazy nigga. Then, for the antics that are written about in this Bird Lives from Charlie Parker, it's like, wow, okay. So it says here, Charlie Parker, he threw his saxophone out of a hotel window. That's one of his antics. He walked into the ocean wearing a new suit, another one of his antics. He drank 16 double whiskeys in 2 hours. 16, y'all. That means at least 8 per hour. Lord have mercy. He rode a policeman's horse into a prominent Manhattan tavern. And then finally, he accommodated a steady stream of women who threw themselves at him. So Charlie Parker was just like, he was a wild man. And, you know, some may have called him crazy for all of that. That's a lot of stuff, man. So that's my first impression after reading these notes. I guess I'll do a quick search online. I know the answer to my question is no. My question is the author Ross Russell still alive? And I think the answer is no. Yeah, because Ross Russell, yeah. So it says here he died on January 31st in the year 2000. He died in Palm Springs. He was born in Los Angeles. Oh, look at that. 10-9, y'all.
You're at 109 right now.
Ross Russell was born March 18th, 1909. But if you add 1 and 9, that's 10, and then you have the rest of the number, 09. So the year, 1909, that's still a reference to 10-9. So there it is. So anyway, I'm going to get back to reading this book. And I'll get back to you when I do. Ross Russell's Bird Lives.